next speaker.
Now you can.
All right.
Okay.
So if all of my judges are ready, you ready to start the time?
And you can see okay?
Yes. All right, then I'll begin. My mom is an art teacher. In the greater Seattle area, near where I live, many museums are free the first Thursday of every month. Because of these two things, I have been to the Seattle Art Museum more times than you can shake a paintbrush at. I love art, especially paintings. And as you probably have guessed, my all-time favorite painting is Vincent van Gogh's The Starry Night. Today, I'm going to show you how to paint three elements of The Starry Night: the swirl, the moon, and the tree. The first element will be the swirl in the sky, during which I'll explain Van Gogh's art style. The second element will be the moon. I'll tell you a bit about Van Gogh himself while I paint the moon, and finally, the tree. I'll analyze this specific painting while I paint the tree, so let's get started. Now, as you can see, the rest of the sky is pre-painted, using lots of short, layered brush strokes of color. And for this big swirl, I'll use the same technique. Impressionism began in the 1860s, when painters such as Edward Monet, along with Renoir, Monet, Degas, and Cézanne, began the Impressionist movement. The camera had been around for about 40 years by that time and had begun to displace realistic portraits. The camera was faster. The camera was more accurate. The focus of the Impressionist movement, however, was not about accuracy. Degas said, "When you go out to paint, try and forget what object you have before you. Rather, draw not what you see, but what you remember." And Van Gogh's memory may have been recalling the swirl of the Milky Way that he saw on a dark night. And I believe this collaborated with his imagination. As an Impressionist, he would try to capture the feeling of this memory. And the feeling of seeing the Milky Way tumble through the galaxy is well captured by the Impressionist style. By using short brush strokes like this, as you can see, this creates the impression of movement. Cézanne put it perfectly when he said, "When you go out to paint, forget what you have before you, be it a field, a tree, a house, or whatever. Merely think, here is a little square of blue, here an oblong of pink, here a streak of yellow, and paint it just as it looks to you, the exact color and shape, until it emerges as your own naive impression of the scene before you." Now, I think that this style of art is beautiful. But art critics of the time thought it was ridiculous. One of the critics, Louis Leroy, actually said, "Impression. Wallpaper in its embryonic state is more finished." Which pretty much sums up what the general public thought of this revolutionary art style. Now to the moon. To paint the moon, you're just going to use the same technique that we used for the sky, but you'll need to flick your wrist a bit more to give a more round brushstroke. While I'm working on this, let me tell you a little bit about Vincent van Gogh. Van Gogh was a minister's son. He tried several different vocations and finally decided to become a painter when he was 27. Throughout his life, Van Gogh combated depression, anxiety, and some say bipolar disorder. In 1888, for example, Van Gogh cut off his own ear after threatening his friend with a knife in a fit of dementia. He was hospitalized and painted a portrait of his doctor to thank him. Dr. Ray, however, did not like the painting, and you'll never believe this, but he actually used it to patch a chicken coop before finally just giving it away. Very poor choice on his part, as that painting is now estimated to be worth $50 million. So now that I've gotten a little bit further on the moon, you can see how these curved brushstrokes create the impression of radiating light. Shortly after the ear incident, Van Gogh admitted himself to an asylum in St. Remy for a year. Fluctuating between periods of madness and creativity, he created some of his best paintings, and The Starry Night was one of them. But on July 27, 1890, just a few short months after he left the asylum, Van Gogh sustained a gunshot wound and died 2 days later. It's unknown whether this was self-inflicted or if somebody else accidentally shot him and he was covering for them. That is an unsolved mystery from his life.
So we've painted the sky, we've painted the moon. Let's move on to the tree. The tree is a little bit different to paint. It serves as a sort of bridge from the earth to the sky, a bridge that your vision can walk upon. So far, I've only shown you how to paint using short brush strokes to create movement and light, but if you paint one long stroke from bottom to top, it draws your eye upward, leading from the quiet town to the vibrant sky. And that's one of the things that I've noticed about this painting. If you look a little bit closer, there are a few others. And one of those is that the relationship between the size and placement of the tree and church provides depth and adds just a hint of reality to this otherwise whimsical painting. Another thing you might notice is how the big swirl in the sky, though at first glance it may appear to be just a burst of frenzied brushwork, is actually centered above the vanishing point, which is just fancy art terminology for the place towards which everything shrinks and eventually vanishes. So what I hope you can go away with today is the knowledge that by using these brushstrokes, you can achieve the Impressionist technique. In fact, short brushstrokes did most of the work for us today. They created motion in the swirl, radiant light around the moon, and they lined up in the tree to point us to the sky. Brushstrokes like these are half of the Impressionist technique. The other half? Observation, imagination, and practice. Lots and lots of practice. The best part is that the act of painting in and of itself is enjoyable and valuable. Art therapists would agree. They help people paint because it's been proven to reduce stress and anxiety, even if you're not a master. So as you go out and start painting or maybe continue painting, I have a feeling that at some point you may get discouraged. I know I certainly do. But it always helps me to remember this one thing Van Gogh said. If you hear a voice within you say you cannot paint, then by all means paint, and that voice will be heard.